think it's very important. I think we need to always focus on institutions, particularly mental institutions, and how we are treating people who are not in a place where they can advocate for themselves. And they need help and guidance. They need to be treated humanely.
Over time, the ideology of mental health has changed dramatically. By the early 20th century, mental health institutions were in a state of tragedy, their patients subjected to unimaginable horrors by an underpaid and overworked staff. One of these patients was Yale graduate Clifford Whittingham Beers, who after his discharge wrote the acclaimed autobiography, A Mind That Found Itself, which triumphantly aroused a movement to better mental health practices of the time, but also fundamentally served to form the stigma and dynamic treatment of the mentally ill today.
Looking to the past, long before the creation of the modern mental hospital, prisons and other depressed facilities were the site of the mentally ill. In an attempt to remove mental illness from society, the mentally ill were often stuffed together by the masses, maltreated in their dingy surroundings.
People were fearful of mental illness, and I think they were fearful because it's not something that was well understood. So they blamed it on things like demons and things that they didn't understand and couldn't control. So they put people in institutions to keep the general public safe, not to help the people who had the problem.
This common treatment lasted through the Middle Ages and Renaissance era, but in the early 19th century, a massive change in thinking occurred. Developed in Europe, a new idea called moral treatment flooded toward the United States. It was defined as a possible cure for mental illness, where those afflicted would seek therapeutic treatment in a new kind of institution, an asylum. In the US, the first asylum built centered around moral treatment was the Philadelphia Quakers' Friends Asylum. This asylum sparked a movement of mental health reform, fondly known as the Renaissance in psychiatry. Many state institutions were created to offer a more civilized approach to convalescence. For the first time, people approached mental illness. In the 1840s, educator Dorothea Dix advocated for the separation of the mentally ill from criminal prisons. Physician Thomas Kirkbride in the mid-1800s developed his Dean Kirkbride Plan, which encompassed moral treatment and called for smaller hospitals with an emphasis on personal privacy, comfort, and environment.
However, then the 1890s came, and with that, the Panic of 1893, considered the worst economic depression of the time in U.S. history. Thousands of businesses failed, where about 1 in 5 Americans were unemployed and impoverished. To combat this, local governments cut costs, reducing mental institutions' funding. Even more, senile elderly residents of public hospitals were moved into state asylums after local governments defined senility as a psychiatric ailment. Immediately after, asylums became overcrowded without the space nor funding available to care for their patients. Essentially, the once caring, therapeutic ideology of asylums lost headway to immense groundskeeping.
Around this time, there was a man named Clifford Whittingham Beers. In 1894, he is accepted in the Yale University Sheffield Scientific School. However, his family had a history of mental illness. That same year, his teenage brother died of an epileptic seizure, the beginning of a trend in which eventually all of Beers' remaining siblings would die in asylums, mainly by suicide. Beers became obsessed with fear that he would suffer the same fate. He later wrote that, "If a brother who had enjoyed perfect health all his life could be stricken with epilepsy, what was to prevent my being similarly afflicted?" His fear was soon realized, where in 1900 he suffered a mental breakdown and attempted suicide. He was immediately hospitalized in 3 different Connecticut asylums. While under the care of these facilities, he observed and personally experienced a plethora of brutal and abusive practices from his own medical staff. "While being subjected to this terrific abuse, I was held in exile," Beers wrote. "I was cut off from all direct and all honest indirect communication with my legally appointed conservator, my own brother, and also with all other relatives and friends." He described being straitjacketed for 300 hours consecutively, kept in rooms resembling jail cells with minimal light or fresh air. Even more, Beers recalled that, "For over a month I was kept in a half-starved condition. Worst of all, winter was approaching and these, my first quarters, were without heat. At last, 3 years later, in September 1903, Beers was discharged from what was his third mental institution. He became determined to share with the public an objective account of the conditions he experienced. Often saying, "I must fight in the open," this determination took the form of an autobiography named A Mind That Found Itself, describing how the perceived insane could in fact understand their mistreatment and separation from society. Published in 1908, the book expressed an outline for new treatment and asylums.
Beers' autobiography was an instant success, creating public outrage fueled by progressive ideals. The book also sparked an ideologic movement to better understand psychiatric sciences and develop improved treatment options, later named the Mental Hygiene Movement. All encompassed by the movement, Beers immediately set to work creating organizations that would help achieve his goal, believing that a book alone could not incite enough change. In 1908, Beers established the Connecticut Society for Mental Hygiene. Used as a trial organization, its purpose was to prevent mental disorders and raise the standard of psychiatric care. Encouraged by its success, Beers established the National Committee for Mental Hygiene in 1909. Much like the Connecticut Society, its goals were to improve the stigma of the mentally ill, improve mental institutions' practices, and prevent mental illness and promote mental health. Even foreignly, Beers was crucial in forming the International Committee for Mental Hygiene in 1919, which later organized the first International Congress on Mental Hygiene by 1930, where 4,000 diplomats worldwide met together to discuss mental health. Relating to the mental hygiene movement, past treatment was rethought using theories like Professor Adolf Meier's dynamic psychiatry, where mental illness is derived from individuals' past experiences. But the movement was strictly ideological, changing public stigma towards mental health positively while not physically able to change practices. An example of this is the Crownsville State Hospital in Maryland, the nation's third asylum for African Americans created in 1910. Coupled with a misunderstanding of mental illness and racism well after the mental hygiene movement, the hospital operated still with inhumane conditions. Oftentimes, patients were neglected, malnourished, and crowded together in close confines.
Regressed conditions like these were common nationwide during the 1930s and 40s due to the Great Depression, with hospitals embracing low medical standards. However, there's a saving grace. On July 3, 1946, President Harry Truman signed the National Mental Health Act, eventually creating the National Institute of Mental Health. Its purpose was to research mental health to create possible cures and methods of intervention for mental illness. Around the same time, many international organizations were established, all basing their values from the ideology of the mental hygiene movement. With help from the Civil Rights Movement and 1963 Community Mental Health Act, state institutions were retired in favor of smaller, local health centers. This trend, known as the deinstitutionalization movement, made the demand of massive asylums obsolete, instead encouraging today's treatment method of individualized therapy.
In all, there was the tragedy of the exponential problems in early 20th century asylums, but then there was the triumph of a single man, able to become one of mental health's greatest advocates. Yes, Clifford Whittingham Beers' autobiography and the following mental hygiene movement did not physically change asylums, but it was the ideas presented in each that changed public stigma for the better, allowing the government to intervene in the 1960s, finally realizing those ideas and changing the understanding of mental health today. But of course, even today, there is always room for improvement. Unfortunately, many consider the deinstitutionalization movement a failure. After the closing of state institutions, those who lacked the ability to hold a job were left homeless in the streets of cities. In addition, over time, public stigma toward the mentally ill has degraded. Those perceived with a mental illness are socially outcasted.
Absolutely. I think, you know, if for example, a family has a child who is diagnosed with some sort of a mental illness, other parents might say, well, I don't want you to play with that child because, he's been diagnosed with this or that. And I think that stigma is very much still there. People still don't understand it well.
And what about recent America? In the wake of mass shootings, society has used mental illness as an excuse not to address larger factors, those being current gun control laws and people's habit to ignore mental health. Most people would agree that we have come a long way from our tragic history of mental health stigma. But given society's current unwillingness to discuss the projected rise of mental health problems, will your children live in a society that triumphs in accepting those who are different?